I'm really excited to go out to DCT and try out a new telescope. Astronomers, we spend most of our time in front of computers, so it's nice to go out and be, you know, out in nature, see the beautiful sky, and get to use a brand new toy like the DCT. I haven't used it before, so that's pretty exciting. I'm a little nervous. I hope I can figure out how it works, but I've used many telescopes before, so I think I'll be able to figure it out.
So behind me is the Discovery Channel Telescope. The upper part is where the telescope is, and that the doors open up when we're ready to observe, and we can swing around the upper part of the building to point the telescope where we want. And this window down here with the bars is where I'm sitting for the whole night for 15 hours.
From here in the control room, we control the instrument, which is taking pictures of the sky, and also the telescope where it's pointed.
We're kind of just waiting for the sun to start setting and then start opening stuff up.
This is 183. Okay, so what was the question? I'm interested in understanding how planets form, and to do that, I look at systems that are very similar to our sun, but much younger. So our sun is 4.6 billion years old, and I look at stars that are 1 million years old. And these young baby stars are surrounded by disks of dust and gas. And these particles come together, they stick and they grow, they form pebbles, boulders, and eventually they keep growing and they form the cores of planets. What we think is happening is that there are planets in these disks, and as they're forming, they're creating the material around themselves and sweeping out the material, leaving behind a hole. So you can think of a hole in a disk as a footprint. These stars that have disks around them, they're still forming. They're still gathering material from the disk at the same time that they're making planets. So I'm going to be looking at two kinds of disks. I'm going to be looking at the disks that have the holes and disks that don't have holes. And the idea is to measure how fast is the accretion onto the star in both classes of objects. The disks that may have planets in them should have lower accretion rates because the planets in the disk are siphoning off of the accretion flow that's going from the outer disk, you know, through the inner region where the planets are forming and onto the star. So a disk that doesn't have planets forming should have a high accretion rate, and the disk that does have a planet forming should have a lower accretion rate because there's a planet in there that we don't see that's sucking up the material. And that'll be another piece of the puzzle that we're putting together circumstantial evidence that we have planets in these disks so that in the future we can look at them and actually begin to image them. So if we can pin down where planets are forming in disks and where they're located, we can start to say we have planets around 1 AU, the distance that our Earth is from the sun. And so they potentially could have life on them. They're habitable.
She's pretty independent. She seems pretty self-confident in what she's doing. Sometimes people have a lot more questions and are a lot more scared about certain little things that pop up.
So usually they don't trust us astronomers to point the telescope in case we break it. So they have the telescope operator point it for you. So it was nice that from my desktop, my control station, I could point and say, I want the telescope to point here, and it would move. So that was cool. I think, you know, with time we get more and more removed from what astronomers used to do with telescopes. You know, we used to go out and actually, you know, in the freezing cold with coats on and like look through a telescope and point it manually, and now we just kind of sit at a computer and click. So, you know, being able to click and move the telescope is like extra excitement for me, you know. And I didn't break it, so I would say it was a success.